what I've done is I have referred to the Arthashastra. So I have characters who say, okay, Acharya Chanakya had said this or something like that, right? Because see, if you think about it from their angle, Chanakya was probably about 900 years prior to that. Nagareshu Kanchi. Jasmine among flowers, Vishnu among men, Rambha among women, and Kanchi among cities. Thus sang the great poet Kalidasa about 300 years before the events in this story took. Kanchi, that fairest of cities. Kanchi, a city that had seen a succession of rulers from the Cholas to the Pallavas since the 2nd century BCE. A city that has been described in the Sangam classic, Perumpana Tripare, as flanked by its belt of defensive jungles is that city. So, namaste all, and thanks to Sangam Talks for giving me this opportunity to share about my book. Before I talk of the book, I would like to set this stage. What I want to do is talk about what India was like during the time when this book is set. Okay, so the time period is the 7th century CE of the Common Era. And it was a fascinating time. Now, this is not something that we learn a lot about in our history classes, because if you remember from history classes in school, typically, you know, we would cover the Aryan invasion theory, the Harappa, Mohenjo-daro. Come from there, we will jump to Buddha. And then from there, we will go to the Mauryas, from the Mauryas to the Guptas. And from Guptas, we will jump, take an almighty leap. We might mention Harshavardhana. We'll have a small chapter on Harshavardhana. We'll mention Pulikeshi, maybe not, depending on which part of India we study in. And then we go immediately to the Delhi Sultanate. Okay. We miss out a lot of our history. And this book is set in a period of history which is actually very, very exciting. So let me paint a picture for you. So what was India like in the 7th? Okay, when I say 7th century, it's from 600 CE to 699, right? India had three very powerful kings at that point in time. So there was King Harshavardhan, who was ruling out of Kannauj. There were the Chalukyas, who were based out of what is now called Badami in Karnataka, but which was called Vathapi in those days. And the great Chalukyan king was Pulikeshi II. Then further down south in Kanchipuram was the great king Narasimhavarman Pallava, who was also known as Ma Malla. Ma Malla meaning great wrestler. Okay. The modern town of Ma Mallapuram, which is also called Mahabalipuram, was named after him. Okay. So that is Ma Malla. So you had three great kings at that point in time. There were some other kingdoms. So there were the Gangas who ruled from Talakad, which is in Karnataka again, very near Mysore. Then you had the Pandyas. The Pandyas were an ancient Tamil kingdom, but at this point in time, they were a much smaller kingdom than the Pallavas. You also had kings in Sri Lanka, or Lanka as it was known then, who were very important. Now, something that I need the audience to remember is that I don't want folks to start thinking of kings based on the current, how the boundaries of the current Indian states is. So I don't want you, when I say Pulikeshi, it doesn't mean Pulikeshi was a Kannada king only. Because Pulikeshi ruled over large parts of Gujarat, Madhya Pradesh, Andhra Pradesh, Telangana, southern parts of Maharashtra, and a lot of Karnataka, and some parts of Tamil Nadu as well. So, you know, do you call him a Kannada king? I don't think so, because language was much more fluid then. People knew a lot of, they could converse with each other. So I don't want people to go away thinking of kings from based on where the current locations of their capitals are. Okay. So one of the things, one of the important pieces to remember, and this is never taught to us, is that Indian kings and or South Indian kings and Lankan kings have been interfering in each other's politics for a long time. So this whole Tamil, you know, Sinhala peace that's happening, it's been happening for thousands of years. It's nothing new. Lankan kings have always interfered in South Indian kingdoms and their affairs. Likewise with the South Indian kingdoms. So at this point in time, the Pandyas, there was one king called Tribhuvana in Lanka who was allied with the Chalukyas. But his rival to the Lankan throne, a king called Manavamma, he was allied with the Pallavas. So you had two Lankan kings, one siding with the Chalukyas, the other siding with the Pandyas. Okay, so this was the overall political landscape of India at that point in time. Three great kings, a few other kingdoms, but all of them allied to one or the other of these. Now, if you think about religiously, from a religion perspective, this was again a very, very interesting time because this was the point in time where Buddhism was probably at its peak. Jainism also was at its peak. There were a lot of Jain monks, Buddhist monks, Takshila, Nalanda, all these universities were, you know, flourishing at that point in time. And you had Huan Sang, the, I don't know how many of you remember from history in school, but the Chinese, you know, pilgrim, Huan Sang, who was a Buddhist pilgrim, he had come to India and he actually started his journey from Takshila in the northwest, in what is now Pakistan, came down all the way to Kannauj, met Harshavardhana, then went all the way to the east, took a turn, came down south, went to Kanchipuram, met Narasimhavarman, went up the coast again, went to Badami or Vathapi, met Pulikeshi, then went up north through Gujarat, what is now Gujarat, you know, Maharashtra, Gujarat and all of that. So he had traveled extensively and it's interesting, right? There were three great kings and this Chinese traveler met all three of them. Okay, so I often think of it this way. Let's assume some alien comes to Earth at this point, right? And if the alien comes and he meets in his one journey, he comes to India, meets Narendra Modi, goes to China, meets Xi Jinping, goes to Russia, meets Vladimir Putin, goes to the US and meets Joe Biden, right? So for Huan Sang to have met the three preeminent kings of India at that time was just amazing. And so this is kind of the milieu. Now, in the South, the Bhakti movement was also starting. So the Bhakti movement was a powerful, you can say, a Shaivite and Vaishnavite pushback against the growing Buddhist and Jain philosophies. This 7th century was a period of great churn in India in terms of religious, in terms of politics, social, you know, the social milieu, all of that. So now, I decided to take up this story probably because I had, you know, in 2009, my wife and I, we had taken a trip around Karnataka and we visited quite a few of these places, including Badami or, you know, Badami. And then there are these two places called Aihole and Pattadakkal next to Badami, very near Badami, which where I don't know if how many folks have gone there, but you should because Aihole is like a university for architecture. So you have all these small temples. It's almost like an Aihole consists of one of the most important inscriptions in Indian epigraphy and Indian history because there is an inscription during the reign of Pulikeshi II which actually mentions Kalidasa. Okay, and that's how Kalidasa is in a sense dated to being before the 7th century. Okay, so it's a very, very important inscription. So we had gone there and, you know, the story was kind of playing out in my mind. And so that's when I decided to kind of start working on this. So what's the story about? Now, I'll first lay out the historical facts. The facts are actually very sketchy because we don't really have too much information about that time period. Here is what we know. Okay. We know that Pulikeshi had come down south to Kanchipuram. And he says that he defeated Narasimhavarman's father, Mahendravarman, in battle. Okay? That is known. What is also known is that about 20 years after that, in around 642 CE, Narasimhavarman, there are inscriptions where he says he defeated Pulikeshi in a series of battles, or four battles. The final battle was the Battle of Vathapi. Okay, so if you go to Badami even today, in Badami, the fort is kind of split. There is a cliff. Okay, there are two cliffs. There's a north cliff and a south cliff. The south cliff has all the cave temples. The north cliff is actually the fort. Okay, before you climb up to the north cliff, at the bottom, on a granite wall of rock, there is an inscription by Narasimhavarman Pallava, which states that I defeated Pulikeshi on such and such a day, in such and such a year. Okay, so these are all the facts. There are some epigraphical evidences to show that certain kings were allied with Pulikeshi and certain others were allied with the Pallavas. That's about it. Okay, so if you think of it as a story, there is, it's a 20-year timeline where one king comes, he sacks or he defeats one king, and then his son kind of takes revenge 20 years later. That's about it. So my book is based on that. So it's a trilogy. So the Battle of Vathapi is a trilogy. Nandi's Charge is the first book. Okay. And obviously, the last book will have the actual Battle of Vathapi, where Narasimhavarma is supposed to have, Pulikeshi is supposed to have died in that battle. Okay. The first book, however, is more about strategizing and spycraft. Because think about it this way. Narasimhavarman is going up against a very powerful king. Okay. Although Pulikeshi is getting on in years, which is why I've called him an old lion, right? He's still a lion. He might be getting old, but he's somebody who had defeated Harshavardhana, and he had pushed Harshavardhana north of the Narmada River. Okay? So that's a very, very powerful king. Now, if you want to go and take revenge against such a powerful king, you can't just take an army and go to Vathapi. You have to start building alliances. You have to start disrupting alliances that Pulikeshi might have, trying to sow discord among their alliances, trying to send some spies, and finding other alliances to help you. All of these machinations have to be done before a king can actually set out for battle. So book one talks about how the generals in Kanchipuram, in the Pallava army, are strategizing about how to go about. So they send off spies in different directions, and what happens, where do these spies go, what do they face. That's what Nandi's Charge is all about. Okay, I'm going to stop here. I know it's about 15 minutes, but I'm going to stop here and see if we can make this a conversation.
So you said that this is a fictional, a fiction book. So recently we have observed this trend of, Indian history getting written in fictional form. Like Amish has written a lot of stuff about Mahabharata, Ramayana. But it's very, again, the same bias comes that it's very Delhi-centric or very North-centric. There are very few books which actually try to describe history in a fictional format, and that too, the history that is from the southern part, like you talk about the Cholas, the Chalukyas, the Pallavas. So, like, what inspired you to start with this in the first place? And what were the challenges that you came across? And how did you go about the research and then formulation of the book itself?
Okay. So, actually, Amish's Meluha series was a big inspiration for me in terms of writing. So, I had never written a book before that. So it was reading the Meluha series which kind of, pushed me into putting pen to paper and start writing. Okay. Now there is a difference. So if you think about Amish's books, right, there are two types of books he writes. there is a Suhail Dev, correct? I don't know if you've read Suhail Dev, but Suhail Dev is the historical character, and so that is the historical fiction. The Meluha series, or the Ram, the Sita, and all of that, that is more like Indic, Purana-based stories, right? So there is a subtle difference in how you write these two, because in historical fiction, you can't let your imagination run riot, in the sense you can't put fantasy elements and fantastic, people jumping from here to there, etc., which you could do in a fantasy series. So that is one big challenge when you're writing historical fiction. The other is, you have to do your research. You have to kind of, so I looked at, for example, in Sri Lanka, there is a book called the Mahavamsa, which details the history of Buddhism and all the kings of Sri Lanka for the last almost 2,000-2,500 years. So I read that. I read Nilakantha Shastri's History of South India. I have R.C. Majumdar's 11-volume work of the history and culture of the Indic people. So all of these kind of helped. Also, I visited most of the places I've written about, both in Lanka as well as in India. So all of that helped, because even recently, because I was going to start writing a third book, my daughter and I, we went on a road trip to Badami, because I'd been there in 2009 and I'd kind of forgotten. So I'll give you a very simple example. I'd written a statement saying, the king and his queens were on top of the fort, and the king called for his chariot to come and pick him up to take him down, right? We went this time, and we realized that there was no way a chariot could go up those steps. They were so steep that you had to either walk down or come down in a palki. Okay? So just minor things like this, you have to go and visit a place, because otherwise you will come up writing nonsense. It might make for good reading, but it won't be very, very accurate. So that, the other, what I'm also very thankful for now is technology, because with Google Maps, for example, right, it's very easy to calculate distances. So when I'm writing for example, if a person is on horseback, how long will he take to go from Kanchi to Badami? Vathapi will vary if it's a person on horseback, or if he's on a bullock cart, or if he's walking. Similarly, even this between two places, if you've got an army that's moving, an army will always move much slower than one man or a few people moving. So in order to calculate distances and time and all that, having Google Maps helps beautifully in this day and age. Otherwise, it would have been very difficult. You'll have to look at maps and do your own calculations, etc. Now it's just so easy to do.
Also, would you like to elaborate a bit on the warfare in the story? Because as far as I know, the Chalukyas were, and at the same time, the Pallavas were, so well-versed with the art of warfare. They were so, the Pallava kingdom itself was so fortified that it was not really easy to have such humongous, huge battles, it's not like a fight between a small kingdom and a big kingdom, wherein a big kingdom will just come and annex over the other. So how was the warfare? How was the strategy in the story?
Yeah, so in the first book, there are a series of minor battles, okay, including guys taking up a fort. How do you now? One of the interesting things is you in the second book, for example, there are actually four huge battles that take place. So as an author, I have to make sure that each of these battles is different, right? Now, how can you make it different? So you have to look at the terrain. Is the terrain different? There are, you could have two sieges, okay, of forts, but you have to, as an author, make both these sieges read completely different so that people reading it are not bored. Oh, there's another fort siege. I've seen one. He's writing it the same way. I can't do that. So every battle has to be thought out, planned. You have to figure out what the terrain is, who's going to attack. Are there spies inside who are going to open the gates? Or is there a way where they can do some trickery? What kind of siege engines can they use? Can they use catapults or mangonels and things like that? So there's a lot of strategizing that you have to do. So I take a look at, I have a book about old battles. So I actually read through old battles, look at how even things like, for example, you read battles by Hannibal against the Romans, right? The Battle of Carthage and stuff like that. You can pick up how the infantry moved, how the cavalry maneuvered, what's the double envelopment. So you kind of read all that and then you try and bring everything into play when I'm writing battles.
So as you talk about this, Arunji, I would just like to ask you if there was certain like guiding book or anything when you looked for this strategy, because as far as we know, if we talk about the Mauryans, for example, and or if we talk about Arthashastra, therein Kautilya mentions a lot of strategies, a lot of, you know, the art of, for example, I mean, when they go about it, in the book of Arthashastra, it's very explicitly mentioned, like how they go, how the king should go about war, how he should strategize all his everything. So it's like a guiding element for that kingdom to sort of, you know, in the upcoming years formulate their strategies. So was there any sort of guiding book for the Chalukyas also, or for the Pallavas, for you to refer to them?
No, we don't know that. What I've done is I have referred to the Arthashastra. So I have characters who say, okay, Acharya Chanakya had said this or something like that, right? Because see, if you think about it from their angle, Chanakya was probably about 900 years prior to that. And at that point in time, I'm assuming his works were not lost, like they were in the intervening period. So obviously it would have been like a manual for them to go to, right? Where army guys, cadets would have been taught from that manual. So yeah, so I've taken some of those liberties as well.
We basically take these liberties. So what did you assume? Like Arthashastra was a manual. What else? What else were there?
So, you know, things like, so when they're strategizing in terms of, okay, how do I go and break up my enemy? So there's a lot that Chanakya talks about. He says, if a kingdom has an enemy, a larger enemy next to him, what he should do. If he has a smaller enemy, what he should do. So yes, kind of try and glean from that and then work your way.
Yeah, okay. Interesting.
Can I just read maybe a passage or two from the book, if that is going to be helpful for people?
Yes, please do.
Okay, so I'll read two things. I'll read one, which is a description of Kanchi as it existed then. And the other is a war scene that I want to read. Okay? So let me go ahead. So this chapter is called Nagareshu Kanchi. Jasmine among flowers, Vishnu among men, Rambha among women, and Kanchi among cities. Thus sang the great poet Kalidasa about 300 years before the events in this story. Kanchi, that fairest of cities. Kanchi, a city that had seen a succession of rulers from the Cholas to the Pallavas since the 2nd century BCE. A city that has been described in the Sangam classic Perumpana Tripparai as, flanked by its belt of defensive jungles, is that city whose doors are never closed to those who seek the prize. Lovely like the pericarp of the many-petaled lotus, the navel of the dark-hued lord. Kanchi was a city rich in history, culture, and tradition. Here had lived legendary kings of yore. Here they had laughed and fought, warred and caroused, loved and prayed. Here had lived scientists and mathematicians, poets and philosophers, saints and savants. A place that was one of the seven holiest places for the people of this land in living memory. Kanchi, from where the great Buddhist evangelist Bodhidharma spread Buddhism to China through the Shaolin Temple, where he is said to have initiated the monks into the secrets of the ancient Indian martial arts of Kalaripayattu and Varmakkal. Kanchi, where Buddhists and Jains, Shaivites and Vaishnavites, and Tantrics and Atheists jostled with each other to claim their adherence. Kanchi, a city of 1,000 soaring temples and palaces, of beautiful gardens and lakes, of wide roads and even wider hearts. Kanchi, a city of cowbells and temple bells, of anklets tinkling amidst the colonnaded palaces and temples, of voices of traders raised in welcome from dawn to dusk, of horses, carriages and carts pounding the main thoroughfares, of the tongues of the Tamils and the Andhras and the Kannadigas and their more northern brethren mingling with each other from the bazaars to the debating halls of the many great educational institutions in the city. There was also another, less reputable senior side to Kanchi, the same as for any other big city. This was a city filled with rogues and scoundrels, thieves and pickpockets, fake sadhus and lechers, rowdies and prostitutes. Both these Kanchis existed side by side, but almost as distinct entities. Okay, so that's one passage. I'll just read a passage so this is where an ambush is taking place. The arrows rose up into the sky in a lazy arc. The twang of an arrow is much romanticized. Indian epics are full of the loud twangs of Rama's or Arjuna's bows. Yet, here, no such twangs were heard as the archers pulled their bowstrings and let fly arrows into the air. The arrows rose almost noiselessly, and then, as they reached the zenith of their paths, seemed to stand still before changing direction and gathering speed as they plunged down towards the river. The soldiers heard the arrows first as faint whispers that almost melted into the rustling of leaves along the riverbanks and the flowing of the river. They felt the arrows when they thudded into their bodies with muted thwacks. It was then that the shrieks started. Even as the first set of arrows reached the top of their arcs, the archers had already let fly the next set of arrows. To the soldiers crossing the river, it was as if a continuous sheet of metal, wood, and feathers rained down on them with no hope of escape. Again and again, the archers on the hills notched their arrows to their bowstrings and let them fly. Again and again, the arrows flew into the air and rained down on their enemies. They decimated the cavalry. Horses were emptied of their saddles. Dead bodies floated in the river, stuck with arrows. Here and there, dead horses accompanied their dead masters on their final journey. Panic-stricken cavalrymen tried to turn their horses around, but the pressure from the back, where the infantry had already started to cross, impeded their progress. Some of them tried to move ahead and cross the river. As they came to the banks, the archers along the hill simply mowed them down with their arrows. So I hope, you know, those passages gave you a glimpse of what the book reads like.
Yes, absolutely. So we'll take up a question from Adityji. Adityji, I'm asking you to unmute. You can ask your question.
Namaste, Arunji. My question, I don't know if this is even how relevant it is or naive it is, but this was the question that came to my mind, is for people who don't know the historical context and facts of what you cover in your book, or people who have been exposed to a distortion of that region of history, would they be able to tell the fictional aspect from the factual aspect? Or is there a danger of them being led to more confusion or an incorrect grasp of the actual facts? Why I ask this is because I remember someone who watched Titanic one time, the first time they were watching a Hollywood film, and they genuinely felt that it was an entirely fictional story because they weren't aware that there was an actual ship, that it sunk, and that part was factual, but the rest of the stories wound into it were not. So I'm just thinking from a reader's experience, if you could throw some light on that, please. Thank you.
Thank you. Thanks for the question. So look, you run this risk with any historical fiction novel, right? So I grew up reading, for example, Alexander Dumas and Victor Hugo and others. So, you know, things like The Count of Monte Cristo or The Hunchback of Notre Dame. All of these, there are historical aspects to it, but for the most part, the characters are fiction, right? My job as an author is to tell a story. What I'm trying to do is given how little people in India know about the stories that have happened in other parts of our country, okay? And this is not just about southern history. It could be about Lasit Borphukan in Assam. How many of us had heard of Lasit Borphukan until I think Sanjeev Sanyalji wrote about him? And then now he's becoming turned into a big national hero, which he should have been from the start. So my job as an author is to tell these stories. And all I'm hoping, okay, I'm sure there'll be confusion, right? Because people will think, okay, the characters that he's writing about, did they actually live? Now, for one, I provide some footnotes in terms of characters and, you know, who they were, etc., etc. But if after reading the book, people just go to Google and start searching for Narasimhavarman or whoever, my job is done. Because I know I have ignited that thought in people's minds to go and read up more on our history. And that's all I'm trying. Does that answer your question, Aditi?
Aditi ji, I'm asking you to unmute.
Yes, yes, absolutely. I guess you're just saying it gives them an in into wanting, having that thirst to explore history further. Thank you.
Exactly.
Thank you.
So the first question that came into my mind by looking at the topic was, is there any context about the famous Carnatic hymn by Muthuswami Dikshidhar about Vathapi Ganapatim Bhaje? How did it come from? As if you can explain how the Vathapi Ganesh idol came to Tamil Nadu and became a hymn which is very famously sung in southern part of India, if you can throw some light on that.
So the story goes something like this. Now this is fact. Narasimhavarma Pallava's commander in chief was a person called Paranjyothi. Okay, Paranjyothi in later years became one of the Shaivite Nayanmas and is known as Sirutunda. He was actually a saint. So he was an army commander who then later on transformed into a saint. So the story is that when Narasimhavarma defeated Pulikeshi in Vathapi, so if you go to Badami even now, in that northern spur, when you go up the fort, at the first level, there is a small temple. Which is supposed to be a Ganapati temple. There is no Murti there. Okay? And Paranjyothi or Sirutandar is supposed to have taken that Murti from there and taken it to Tamil Nadu. And I think it's now present in a temple called Tiruchengattang, something. I forget the name of the place. But it has been installed. That is what the story is. So that's why Vathapi Ganapatim refers to that Ganapati that was brought, ostensibly brought by Paranjyothi from Vathapi. However, historians, more modern historians, if you ask them, they say that story is not necessarily true. But I like that story, okay? Because it shows a continuity of civilization. It shows a continuity of cultural connect. So, see, when people say, for example, Mahmud of Ghazni came and broke Somnath, right? And they try and equate it to, let's say, the Vathapi Ganapati. There's a fundamental difference. Mahmud of Ghazni destroyed Somnath, whereas Paranjyothi, let's assume the story is true, he took that Ganapati and it's still venerated after all these thousands of years. So there is a fundamental difference there. That's kind of, so that's the reason I like that story. So I don't know if it is 100% historically accurate, but I hope, or at least I like this story, so I kind of, always remark on that. Yeah,
that is exactly why I wanted to bring that upon, because this is like seen as two kingdoms fighting each other, but then the continuity of the civilization continues, and you find a poet coming out with a new hymn, and it's famously sung by everyone in southern India. So
correct.
I just want to bring it up to you. Thank you.
Thanks.
Yeah, so Arunji, you just mentioned Paranjyothi. When I was reading, it was long back, and I was just reading about this Battle of Vathapi, and that's when I heard that if Paranjyothi wouldn't have been there, the Pallavas, it would have been really difficult for the Pallavas to conquer Snowcat. Chalukyas. So would you like to share some light on this? How important was
I don't think anybody can shed light on this because there is really no information other than the fact that Paranjyoti was a commander of Pallava Narasimhavarman, and the fact that he later on became Sirukonda. There really is no, there are no inscriptions that talk about his role in the battle or war. So anything that you read is mere speculation. So in my book, I'm going to write, he appears in the first book as well, kind of fleetingly. Second book, he appears more. Third book, he will appear even more because that's when the actual wars happen. But anything we write is just purely creative. I don't think there's any information that's actually available.
Okay.
Yeah.
Interesting. So apart from that, I would like to ask you that there were like a series of four battles, right? But you named the book upon the Battle of Vathapi. So do you discuss when you write it in a trilogy, like in a series? So in the first two books, do you discuss all the small battles or all the skirmishes that happened? Or you directly jump?
Yeah. No. So there are a lot of other battles. So the way I've written it, there's a lot of strategizing that happened. There's a lot of mini battles that happen. So all of that take place throughout the first and second books. It gradually builds up. So first book has probably, two, three battles, small battles. The second book has quite a few battles. And then the main four battles that are mentioned in the inscriptions, they happen in the last book.
Okay, all of them happened in the last book.
Yeah, but before that, there are still about six or seven battles that happen.
Oh, between the Chalukyas and the Pallavas.
Yeah, but those are my creative battles.
Okay.
Right? So those are just things that I assume happened. Those are not actual real battles. So if you go by the inscription, there were only four battles that happened between Narasimhavarman and Pulikeshi, with the last battle being the Battle of Vathapi.
So, I've also heard that Narasimhavarman was called as Vathapi Konda, if I'm not
wrong. Vathapi Konda, which is he who conquered Vathapi.
Okay, okay. Yeah. So, conqueror of Vathapi. Okay.
Fine. Conqueror of Vathapi, yes. And, so, for example, the great king Rajendrachola was called Gangai Konda because he had gone up to Bengal. And apparently, he had defeated the Pala kings and he brought back water from the Ganges there. So, Gangai Konda is conqueror of Ganga.
Okay, okay.
Yeah.
And after Narasimhavarman conquered the Chalukyas kingdom and Badami and everything, so it is said that he ruled for 12 years, right? After that, or like how many years?
Who, Narasimha? No, so what happened is the Pallavas had control of Vathapi for 12 years. But after 12 years, Pulikeshi's son, I think Vikramaditya, he reconquered it from them.
Okay.
Yeah.
So again, the kingdom of...
Yeah, so again, see, it's a cyclical thing, right? So by then, Narasimhavarman would have been getting old. So Pulikeshi's son comes in. So history is cyclical. And in those days, that's why I don't really like people taking undue regional pride in kings, because the kings, I don't think he thought of himself as a Tamil king, or this man thought of himself as a Kannada. It is kings who had large regions under their control, and there's always like a rise and fall going on based on how strong or weak.
So, and a last doubt. So I had heard like there are three types of Chalukyas. Like you have the Chalukyas of Badami, you have the Chalukyas of Mahendri, and then you have the Chalukyas of Kalyani. So what exactly is this difference?
No, so the Vengi Chalukyas were actually, Pulikeshi conquered Vengi, and Pulikeshi installed his younger brother, Tabja Vishnuvardhana, as the emperor of Vengi. So after some time, the lines would diverge, right? Because as the generations go on, then they became a kingdom of their own. It happened even for the Cholas. So, after Rajendra Chola, his son, I think his son or somebody married the daughter of a king from the Andhra region. And so you had the Telugu Cholas and then you had the Tamil Cholas. So you had two separate branches at that point in time.
Well, so if we just look at your bio, and it's all tech related stuff and everything. So how did you get interested into all this historical stuff and that to Indic history, looking at it from a fictional point of view? So we would just like to hear your story from you. How was the initiation?
Look, I've always been fascinated by history, although I didn't have, like most of us, we don't have very good history teachers in school, right? I had one very good history teacher in school for 1 year. I remember, I think it was 7th standard or something. I was in Bengal then, and she was teaching us about Ashoka. And she actually went to the National Museum in Calcutta. She copied down the entire Brahmi inscription of one of Ashoka's inscriptions, which is there in that museum. It starts off with Devanam, Piya, Piya Dasi. She copied it out, brought back, came back. I remember she wrote it down on the blackboard. She made us all copy it. She told us what the script meant. And I remember even in our test that year, final exam, she had asked us a little piece and said, what does this mean in the Brahmi script? Right. So I was fortunate to have had her for 1 year. I think but when you're from the south, my father is from Tanjore, and in Tanjore, you have that area has so many temples. So when you go there, you see these. I don't know if you there's this big temple or Periya Koil, Brihadishwara temple, which is in Tanjore. It's humongous, and you go stand there, and you feel like you're transported back in time, right? You can almost feel Rajaraja walking, Chola walking behind you and standing next to you. So I was always fascinated by that. And so it's kind of slowly grew from there.
Right. It's actually interesting to, listen to someone. It's completely a different arena from your work.
I think it's not just me. There are so many of us who are writing now. We don't have a history background as such, right? If you take Sanjeev Sanyal or Amish, everybody has come from, Sanjeev Sanyal is an economist, Amish did his MBA. So I think it's just interest and passion that's driving us.
Yes. And it is said that the more you try to push something down, it's the more magnificently and the strength that comes up. So maybe that's what is happening with Indian history as well. So you talked about the Brahmi script. So I would just like to ask you, when you write a book in English, which is again, which is a history book, so how do you use, are there any, say, Kannada words here? Any words?
I do use Indic words. So, for example, I would use a word like angavastram, which is something that's worn on top. Mm-hmm. But I do provide footnotes, right? Similarly, I would use a word called veshti for a dhoti, because in the south, it's called a veshti, right? So, I would use those terms because I think it's okay. If you read The Hunchback of Notre Dame, you would come across French words. So, if you can read French words, why can't you read other Indic words.
And that's actually a very nice and fantastic way of introducing others to the Indian script also, which I find quite fascinating.
Kailasanatha temple in Maharashtra, which is carved downwards, is said to be a replica of the Kailasanatha temple in Kanjipuram. Does it come in the reign of Pulikeshi, or it's after Pulikeshi?
I think it's after that. The way so my understanding is this. Most of the temples, the great temples in South India, the current structures are probably only about 1,000, 1,200 years old. However, they have that deity has been there for more than 2,000 years.
Okay.
So you would have brick temples or something. And as each kingdom comes, they would keep building on top of it. And that's how it is. But I think the deities, so if you take Parani or if you take Tirupati, all those, the deities are really very, very old. They're not, there's been continuous worship there for almost 2,000 years or so.
Thank you for the wonderful presentation and the reading out of the book. I mean, it's made for fascinating reading. I am a history enthusiast and a history writer myself. And of course, you're right that this period of history is a lesser known period. But my question was more related to how you bring out, or what is your approach about writing on a historical period. If we may call it a period book or a period drama, if we were to talk about in videographical terms. So talking about Titanic, someone mentioned Titanic, and Titanic is not only that that movie, it not only has, that just few, if this thing, the Titanic movie is actually a very accurate movie, because I've read quite a lot on the Titanic, the newspaper reportages at that time and all that. So, I mean, it's a very beautifully compiled this thing of small incidents, how the band was playing, what happened and things like that. So it is not that it is a story built around a historical incident. The incidents also have been picked out. So I was listening to you, and since you described the book as a fiction, yet you say that you have gone to so much of detail, and that is, I mean, absolutely amazing. You know how much you figure out that it's not possible to come down from that place with a chariot, so that accordingly. So this requires a lot of detail, and the battles are battles are accurate historically. Incidents. The characters are historical incidents. So what part would you actually describe? And then you also say that you have made a lot of reference to contemporary literature and the likelihood of that literature being accessible to kings in the area, the region which you cover. So how you're describing it as a fiction, would you say it's more of a screenplay? Of course, it's not a screenplay, but it's kind of a animation of the entire scene rather than being a fiction.
No, so I call it, so it's part of the historical fiction genre. Right now, in historical fiction, there are always, obviously, there are characters who actually lived in reality. There are certain facts which are irrefutable. So, for example, the fact that Narasimhavarman went and defeated Pulikeshi in Vathapi, it's an irrefutable fact because there are inscriptions available. But you can't really build a story just based on that. So you have to introduce your own characters. Now, there are a lot of characters. There are spies. They have love interests. There are romantic interests, etc., etc. All of that is fictitious, right? Because all of that is a figment of my own imagination. So that's why I'm saying that this is historical fiction, because while the germ of the idea is in historical facts, the way it unfolds is based on the creative liberties that I have taken. So, even the battles, all we know is that there were four, and this is mentioned in like two lines in an inscription, that Narasimhavarman defeated Pulikeshi in the battle of Manimangala, Suramara, Parivala, and Vathapi. You have names of four cities, okay? Of which only two of these cities you even know where they are. Manimangala is about 20 miles northeast of Kanchi, and Vathapi is Badami. What was Suramara? What was Parivala? Nobody knows. So I have to kind of make some educated guesses, or even come up with some place which I call Suramala, because there is no information extent that tells me what is this place. So that's what I mean by saying that. And again, the battles, how did these battles happen? What actually happened in the battles? We don't know. So there is, again, creative liberties that I've taken based on how I have formed the chain of events. And that's what informs how these battles. Does that answer your question, Upulji?
Yes, it does. It does. In fact, this is, of course, understood that you would have used a battle happened. I mean, how it happened to recreate. Obviously, you have to use a lot of narratives, a lot of characters. who fighting whom, who got hurt, how he got hurt, is someone, something. So unless you build stories around characters, it is not interesting. You're very right. What my question was that how far, I'm comparing it with the Titanic example, how far is it actually historically accurate? So you would say, I mean, taking everything into consideration, considering the details, the distances and all that you have taken into consideration, it is still very accurate.
Yeah, so I would put it this way. It is accurate. I have tried to make it as accurate as possible in terms of the social mores, the way of dressing, the food that they eat. All of those things, I've done quite a bit of research to try and, you know, give that flavor for what existed at that point in time. So in that sense, I've tried to make it accurate. But obviously, the events are not necessarily going to be historically accurate for the most part.
That's amazing. I'll definitely read this book. Another last question. All three, you're saying it's a trilogy, so all three are now out, is it?
No, the first book is out. The second book should be out in another, I'm hoping by May. And I'm in the process of writing the third book now. I've probably done about maybe 2/3 of the book. So I'm hoping to release that by the end of the year.
I hope that answers your question, Lapurji. And Arunji, I would just again like to confirm that the book is available in hard copy and online format.
Yes, it's there. On, if you go to Amazon, you will get it both in paperback and on Kindle.
Okay. And for your readers who are going to, who have no, for example, let's consider that they have no idea about what the battle was and how the kingdoms were at that time. So do you, prescribe them certain reading or maybe before getting into your book?
No, I've actually provided a map in the book, which also talks about, it shows what the kingdoms were and so on. So yeah, you don't need to do any pre-read to do this. You can pick it up and start reading it just like a story.
Okay.
And I'll just show you. So this is the book. Oh, 1 minute. I think we stopped my. I think I'm blurred my background. So
yes.
Take it off. Okay. So that's the Battle of Vathapi. So you can see two flags. That's where Badami is. That's Kanchi, and the flags represent the insignias of the two kingdoms.
May I ask a question? What temple is it at the top of the book cover?
I think that is, if I'm not mistaken, that's not necessary. I think it's one of the temples in Kanchi. I don't recall. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
I just thought it's somewhere in Mahabalipuram.
It could actually be one of the Mahabalipuram temple, actually. Yeah, I think that was where I got it. Correct.
Yeah, I just sent the question on the chat box, actually. You were shutting off, so that's why I quickly raised my hand. So, well, like you said, I mean, again, going on the accuracy part, the flags that you have shown, the insignias are also accurate, you would say, than you've done, because I'm really fascinated with the amount of research that the detailing you have done. So I'm just trying to get a hang of it.
Yeah.
Thank you.
No, the insignias are accurate because... there are inscriptions in both Kanchi and in Badami with the insignias of the king. So Varaha, which is the boar, was the insignia of the Chalukyas. The Pallavas used two insignias. One was Nandi and the other was Simha, which is the lion. So Nandi's charge, because Nandi is charging. The second book is called Varaha's Vengeance. Okay. And the third book, I'm not going to let out the name right now, but I have it in my hand.
Yeah, amazing titles. Thank you so much, Arunji, for your
time. Thank you.
And we are very happy to have you on Sangam Talks. Thank you, audience, for joining in.